Welcome to the fourth day of the Easy Build user meeting. Our first talk today is going to be about modules 5, the environment module system. I'll ask Xavier to tell us about this.
So thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a real pleasure for me to be here to talk to you about modules. First of all, let me introduce myself. I am Xavier de la Ruelle. By now, you should know that I'm French. I work at CEA, which is the Alternative Energies and Atomic Energy Commission. And at CEA, I am the Operation Manager of TGCC, which is CEA's Computing Center for European Research. And since 2017, I am also the Project Leader for Environment Modules. Some more words on HPC at CEA. This is a major topic for the Institute, both for research and operational activities. We run two large production level facilities, one for defense and the other ones for academics and industry. And also, we have a strong investment in open source solutions since almost two decades. With either contribution to existing solutions like Cluster or Slurm, or by developing our own. You may know some of them like Cluster Shell, Phobos, Robinhood, NFS Ganesha, and so on. So now let's move to the main topic, environment modules. This project has turned 30 years old last year, and it is not dead, far from it. The development have restarted in 2017, and it is really active since then. We ship two or three feature releases each year. In each of them, you will find five new features, and among that, each year, there is one big feature release. Of course, we also do bug fix releases when bugs are spotted. And in overall, this software is widely available in Linux and other Unix distributions. I would like to give you this big picture of all the new stuff that were added since modules version 3.2, which is the version shipped in EL7. You may use this OS, you may also use this old version. And in 5 years, we have added all these new subcommands, all these new command line switches, configuration options, and module file commands. So I would like to tell you how these things are developed. The big philosophy here is to stay as close as possible to standard tools and concepts. So inspiration is taken from basic commands like ls, grep, git, and also DNF and apt for all the dependency management stuff. Also, the big point is to stay backward compatible as much as possible. So of course, a lot of new features are added, but if they break an existing behavior, they are disabled by default to ensure upgrade will run smoothly. Everything is also EVD tested. We have just reached the 17,000 non-regression tests. All of that is run through the Deja GNU framework. And the full test suite for after each published commit, it's run through continuous integration to a various kind of host like EL, EL-like host, Debian, SUSE, OSX, Windows, and FreeBSD. And since a few years now, there is a massive improvement on the documentation. Now, even before starting to develop a complex feature, we write design notes to explain how we'll do it. Once feature is developed, we highlight it with a small example. So users, for each new version, they can have the list of the new feature added with a small example to explain how to it could be used. There is also more consistent cookbook recipes where we take all the options that a new feature makes available to provide big examples. And there is also a changes document where you can track everything which is changed from one version to another. So let's talk about module 4 before talking about module 5. Module 4, the first version 4.0 was published in October 17, and the last feature release was published in July of last year. So I will provide you now a guided tour of the major features that were introduced during module 4. The first one is what we called automated module handling. It was added in version 4.2. Is first the consistency added to the loaded environment regarding the dependencies expressed by loaded modules. And in fact, when new modules are loaded or when loaded modules are unloaded, there is now first a check that all the requirements and conflicts expressed are still correctly satisfied. And on top of that, we have added automatic mechanisms to automatically load the requirements and to automatically unload the dependent module and reload the dependent module that can still survive after one dependency removed. This is the first example I have on the right. We try to load AppY, an application which requires libb. So by loading AppY, resolution automatically load the library. But then if afterward we unload libb, it will automatically unload AppY. So this feature, it handles simple but also complex use cases with, for instance, dependency cycles, and it can also heal inconsistent environment. And this is what we see in the last example on this slide. If we force to load AppY without dependency resolution, afterward, if we load libb, it will automatically reload AppY, and then as a consequence, the user will get again a consistent environment. Next, let's move now to advanced module version specifiers, a new feature added in version 4.4. It's to the ability to specify finer constraints to select module versions. It uses the SPAC terminology and syntax, the famous @ plus version specification. And with that, you're able to express a list of version, range of version, and even ranges within versions. Small example on the left. If we see all the full modules available, there is 5, and we can then say, I only want to see version 1.2 and above. And this filter, you have it on module avail, you have it also on module load. This is the second example. The big thing here is that this specification could be used everywhere a module specification is expected. And on top of that, this is the same syntax, whether you use it from the command line or within module files. And on the example at the bottom, we see here a bar 2.3 module that express a prereq against foo, but against only two specific versions of foo. So it's really convenient to be able to use the same syntax everywhere to do this finer constraint selection. Next topic, this one added in version 4.6. It's the ability to dynamically hide or forbid evaluation of module files. Two new module file commands for that to put in module RC files, module hide and module forbid. There are a lot of options to these commands. Of course, they can leverage the advanced version specifier syntax we have just seen. But you can also say, I only want to hide or forbid before a given date, after a given date. Or you can also do some exception for a list of users or for a list of our Unix groups. Regarding more specifically dynamic hiding, there is different hiding level, soft, regular, and hard. A hard hidden module, you will not see it even if you precisely specify its name and version. Whereas a soft module, if you query them, you will see them. So this is the example on the right. We put module hide command in the .module.rc file for the CUX module, where we define a soft level hiding for all the CUX modules. So then if we do a module away, we only see the bar modules. But if we want to see specifically the CUX modules, you will see them. And if you want to load them, there will be a resolution. The big use case here is to hide dependencies that are not used by end user. For instance, with EasyBuild, you may end up with a M4 or Zlib module file, but the users, they will not use that. And it's interesting to limit the view of what is available by default for your users, for them to focus on things really useful. So you can, this way, softly hide such modules. But then there will be no problem to load them when you will resolve a dependency express in other modules. Also, dynamically hide also apply once module is loaded. So you can also use an option to say, this module, I want to have it also hidden in the module list once loaded. So this way also, you will limit the view of the loaded module to only focus on things that are useful for user. Dynamically forbidding modules is really useful if you want to expire some module files. There is some message provided to the users to tell them they can use the module is forbidden for them. Of course, you can tune this message. This such message, and also when a module is forbidden in less than 2 weeks by default, it is considered nearly forbidden, and there is a warning for the users to anticipate a migration to another version. And of course, this 2 weeks delay it can be configured. Next feature, modules tags introduced in version 4.7. It's this simple idea to associate piece of information to module files. Tags, they are either inherited from module state, consequence of module action, or you can also set these tags manually using the new module tag command you put in module RC. Small example on the right. We set some tags with through the .module.rc file for the foo module. And you see these tags then they appear on the output of module avail or module list once the module is loaded. For your own tag by default, it will just print the tag name or the abbreviation configured for the tag along next to the module name, the module denomination. But also you can configure specific color to graphically render, this is the second example, to graphically render the module name and version with a color defined for the tag. And at the end of the output, you have a key section which say, okay, foo 1.0, it's red because it is forbidden for you. Last feature that I would like to highlight for modules 4, it's module variants added in version 4.8. It is just this simple idea to pass arguments to evaluated module files. Module files, they are script, so you can pass argument to a script. This is barely this ID. And then within the evaluation of the module file, you get the arguments provided in variables, and you can adapt your code. For instance, here in the example, to define a specific location for environment variable like path. In fact, variance is this ability to have one module file which handle behind several installation for the same software version. When specifying variants, you use again SPAC syntax. You can have Boolean variant, evaluated variant. And to ease the specification, you can also define shortcut. And here, a small example. At the bottom of the slide, we define a shortcut for the toolchain variant, and then using the percent sign. And then we can just use percent value to say we want this value of the toolchain variant and variant. Then you see what variant you load in yellow by default. And when you list loaded module, you see also what are the variant loaded for these modules. So what I have just shown you, a lot of new stuff that has been added, a lot of new options, and all of that you can configure it at build time by just passing option, enabling or disabling option with the configure script. But of course, you can also use the default package you will have for your distribution, and then use the init.rc script, which is a modules initialization file. And in that, you are able to put your own site-specific configuration for modules. Init.rc, it's just a TCL script which supports module file commands. So you can use module config command to finally configure your setup. And this is also in this file that you can define the default environment for your user by using module use or module load commands, or even just module restore to restore the default collection of your user. If you want to go a bit deeper in the customization, there is a site-specific script, siteconfig.tcl. And in this script, you are able to define hooks for existing procedure in the module cmd.tcl script, which is the script behind the module command defined in your shell environment. And you can do that by just either superseding existing procedure with the rename tcl command, or to execute, define new procedure your own at the start or at the end of any regular procedure of module CMD with the trace tcl command. And we provide a deep example of that to in the cookbook recipe to show how you can log every module command that evaluate a module file. This is a link provided below. So let's move to modules 5. 5.0 was published on September of last year. So we have migrated to a new major release number, mainly to enable by default the big feature of modules 4 to let user benefit by default from an enhanced experience. And now in modules 5, you have automated module handling and advanced module version specifier enabled by default. And the idea also was to catch the train toward RHEL 9, which is in beta stage now. So 5.0 is out. Currently, we are working on 5.1. So I will give you some information on the current development trends. First feature of 5.1, it's a new configuration introduced to boost the module search performances. By default, every files under module paths, they are red to determine if they are module files or not. So in 5.1, we will add a configuration option to just say, consider all files under module paths are module files. So if you do so, you avoid a lot of IO calls And this is a small example on the right. We see here a setup with a bit more than 1,000 module files. And by enabling or disabling the new configuration with strace, we are able to compare the number of syscall. And what we can see is with the new mode, you remove one close, one open, and one read IO call for each module file you have. Here in this setup, there is a big drop of IO calls. So depending of your storage configuration and also of your general IO load, depending, for instance, of the number of active user you have, you can see a massive improvement using this new configuration option. But if you use that, you must be in full control of what is inside your module paths, because everything will be considered as module files. A second ongoing development, version 5.1, it will bring compatibility with TCL module files written for LMOD. So the objective here is to be able to evaluate a TCL module file written for LMOD without an error. And objective is to ease the life of people who write module files or people who write tools to generate module files. So some TCL module file commands introduced by LMOD were already added in previous version of modules, but here with 5.1, we have implemented all the remaining one, like family or pushenv. And just for add property, remove property, and extensions, this is what I call a dummy support, because these are specific concepts of LMOD. And currently, if they are formed in module files, they will be rendered as a no operation, but no error will be raised. I would like now to provide you a small comparison between the unique features of LMOD version 8.6 on the left and the unique features of the upcoming version 5.1 of modules on the right. So the idea here is to give you a simple view, and with that, and depending on the things you currently use and or the thing you would like to use in the future, you are able to determine at this moment what is the best environment, the best module solution for you. So I have checked with Robert, the developer of LMOD, that it was okay with him, and in order to provide a very a fair view of both solutions. And one last word on this table is that there is some features that are specific, but you can find an equivalence in the other solution. Just a small example, the nag message. There is no nag message in modules, but module forbid, it implement this use case. And this is also the same, for example, for module properties on LMOD. There is no properties in modules, but modules tag is quite the same thing. One last point I would like to highlight for version for the upcoming 5.1 version is the work to improve the capabilities to tag things. First of all, to be able to tag a module when loading it. Not only relying on the tags defined in module RC file. And this new option added, --- tag, it will be available from the command line or within module file in all commands that can load module files, like prereq, depends on module load, and so on. And we will also extend the tag concept to module paths to be able to afterward associate specific behaviors to module files depending on the tag they will hold. So after 5.1, 5.1, it should be available by the end of March. After 5.1, there will be 5.2. And for 5.2, the big focus will be to allow advanced search queries to be able to search for module files based on their properties. So the idea, and this is a small example I put here, this is not the definitive syntax. Design notes are not written yet. The idea here is, for instance, to be able to list all the available modules that fulfill a given tool chain, that require a specific module, or that are tagged here in this example, nearly forbidden. And of course, this is not the last thing that will be developed on module. There is a lot of new cool stuff to add. Maybe in 5.2 also, I will implement finally a module file cache. I have no good view of how to do it with one cache file per module path. And with a cache that contains everything to avoid further evaluation of files, but yet to keep things really dynamic, because maybe on your site you may have module RC files that render the list of available modules really dynamic. And you should avoid that the cache file contain only the view of the one user that has generated this cache. It should stay totally dynamic for all users. After caching mechanism, new automated module handling mechanism will be added. First one to automatically unload conflict, and another one to load compatible version. Rather default version, to be able to progressively load an environment that is really consistent. And especially if you want to load all the modules of the same toolchain variant, this feature will be really interesting. Another topic that I mentioned here, funny one, is to the ability to stash and pop the environment, and it will be easily done relying on collection. And that's it for the next development topics. But of course, this is fully open to new ideas, to your ideas, and even your developments. You can submit pull requests. You can come to the mailing list also to discuss new stuff. So this is the end of my presentation. I would like to add one last point. If you want to keep in touch with the progress of the project, there is a Twitter feed I have put here. And each time a new feature is available, I post a message there and a link toward a small example to see what the new feature does. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Xavier, for that. If people have questions and they're in Zoom, please do raise your hand in Zoom and we'll allow you to ask them. So I think I'll start with a question. It's one that Kenneth asked me to ask, but I've also sort of got the same one. TCL. Do you ever get annoyed at writing it or using it? And are there any considerations for allowing modules in different languages to TCL?
No, I am very, very used to it, and I find it really powerful. Maybe I am the only one on earth that thinks that. When you begin TCL, it could be a bit frustrating regarding how it handles strings. But this is also a powerful feature. So myself, I am really used to it. But the issue I can see is finding developers that that work on TCL. So there is multiple paths. Now that I have said that, first one on the user side, being able to write module files in another language than TCL. There is a really new active project, which is called Tohill, which provides a bidirectional interpreter between TCL and Python. And since a few years from now, I have this idea to be able to write module files in Python. Could be interesting. And on the developer side of the module command, what could be done maybe in the future is modulecmd.tcl, there is an extension library written in C. And so you can extend the modulecmd command by just writing C. And then as TCL is really well bridged with a compiled language like C, you can just write a TCL procedure, you can write a C procedure and expose it to the TCL environment. So with this extension library, it will be possible to extend modulecmd.tcl by writing C, rather by writing TCL code. And if we think also a bit more further, we can even say that this extension library maybe rewrite it totally from C to Rust, which is now a very popular language. And so maybe there will be a bit more attractiveness to the project because maybe people, there will be more contributors to work with Rust than to develop in TCL. But maybe to conclude on this question, what I have seen from the past is that for any module command or any module project, there were not more than one main developer. So this ideal situation to have not only one core developer but multiple one for such project, I do not know if it is really possible compared to what we can see for such small project in HPC. But there is ways. You see, I have already some plans. It can be worked. It's not so difficult to extend either on the module file side to write new module files in Python or on the development or the module command with C or Rust.
Okay, thank you. And Kenneth had a second question, and this is the I'm trying to check. Yeah. So modules as a tool is, you know, it's been around quite a long time. If you could go back to the beginning and do something differently, is there an old design decision that you would go, oh, I wish we'd known about that, we'd known really early on and we could have done something differently? Particularly as you were talking about not wanting to, with new versions, not wanting to break compatibility with old versions.
Maybe it's simply the major issue, I think, with such a solution is the way the files are organized, because we see putting just this information in a full flat file hierarchy with directories and files on HPC storage system, when you have hundreds of active users, it can generate a lot of load. So an interesting thing to, I think when they started that 30 years ago, it was not an issue, but now it is one. And this is why I have done this new configuration option, especially to avoid reading every file to see are there module files, are there not. If they are in module pass, there is a good chance that they are module files, so we can just skip this test. And we can also think to use different backends to have this historic file backend, but you may also have some database and stuff like that to store the files. This is the only big point I see as a big issue, a big design issue. All the other things, I am quite happy the way it works. And this is also my the way I do things. I modify things slowly, not to break compatibility, but to add new things. And after a few years, you can see a big difference without breaking anything. Other questions?
Yeah, that was what we're just seeing, whether we have any. One of the questions from Slack is, question moved away. There we are. Are there any plans to offer migration scripts from AOMOD Lua to modules 5? Because obviously some sites have now moved from modules to AOMOD. So, you know, any thoughts about aiding people moving back the other way? With a follow-on part to the question, or is it just better to start from scratch for sort of the sorting out your configuration and anything else?
I do not plan to provide a Lua to Tickle conversion. Especially that I think that a lot of users, they can just barely, if they use EasyBuild, for instance, they can just barely regenerate the module files, changing just an EB option. But if in the end, a lot of people need such a script, I could do it. But I am not especially, I do not do that. I would like to emphasize on that. I do not do that, especially to take back people that are currently using LMOD. If people are satisfied with LMOD and if they use their fond of Lua, there is no problem. They could stay with LMOD. An interesting thing to do it would be maybe to extend the source sh new module file command. I know that Robert will tell you a bit of this new module file command. Currently, it enables you to put shell scripts and to execute them in module files and to translate them back as if the code that change on the environment were fully written within the module file. So currently you can do that for SH, CSH, fish, shells, ZSH, KSH, and we could also think to add backend for other stuff like LMOD, maybe for instance. So there will be this way a tickle module calling an LMOD module, and if LMOD is also installed, it will interpret the Lua module, and then you will get it in on your side on modules. And on a broader perspective, you have multiple module solution, but now you also have multiple tool that do not use module anymore and provide their own environment management capabilities like SPAC with SPAC load, or also things like Gix. And with that, you lose this objective of module to have a single command, kind of API to handle your environment. Everywhere you go, you have the same module command to load and unload. Ever you are using environment modules or LMOD, it works quite the same. And we can also think to extend. This is an interesting idea I have to write different backends also to be able to present like if there were module files, but to present the result of a SPAC list or SPAC find a command, or to bridge an environment that were built with SPAC or with Gix, to be able to present it along with other native module files. So a lot of things can be done, and very interesting stuff here.
Were there any more questions for Xavier? I'm not seeing any at the moment. So I think at that point we'll say thank you. Been very interesting to learn more about modules. And giving us thoughts about them. So thank you to Xavier for giving this presentation.
Thank you.